Hello, this is Fredrik here. In this video, we will be taking a look at the SPC operator, the Space Colonization operator, which is the core MeshOp in Tropism. This MeshOp simulates growth in the scene using attractor points. And the result here is a structure of curves. If you want a deeper technical understanding of how the SPC operator works, take a look at the first video in this series. All right, so let's start by adding a point scatter mesh up to the scene. And here you can see the attractor points in the shape of a basic tree. On top of that, we add the SPC operator. Now you can see that we have a very basic structure of curves here. I will drag this mesh up into the schematics, and you can see we have a locator connected to the root, and here's the mesh that we are operating on. We also have the point scatter mesh up here. Let's select the SPC operator. Take a look at the form here at the right side of Modo. First of all, we have the enable disable checkbox, and then we have something called remove attractors. The remove attractor feature removes all points that is scattered by the point scatter meshup. This is if we don't want the points to propagate up in the stack to other mesh operators. For instance, when working with replicators, generating leaves on the tree structure, we want this checked because we don't want leaves at all of those points that is used for the SPC operator. Then we check this. Okay, then we have something called a strategy. A strategy, you have two choices here. One is brute force and one is octree. And you should always use the octree version because it's way faster than the brute force version. The brute force version is here for reference. If you run into problems, you can try the brute force version and see if you get different results. And of course, if you get different results, I would like to know. But use the octree version as default. Well, looking at the next parameter, the polytype, this is the type of curve that is generated. And you have none, you have line, and you have curve. And the line is polylines, the curve Modo polylines, and these lines are way faster to generate than the curve lines. So when you use have a scene where you paint vines onto a mesh, for instance, you want to use the polyline as long as you are developing the look and feel. And when you want to render out the final result, you choose to set it to curve. Under the curve generation section here, you have something called display main branches. And this draws the dots on all vertices on the main curve in the curve structure. If you have several roots locators connected to this SPC operator slot, the root locator slot, you will see that each root has a main curve, and then you can mark it with this checkbox. Sometimes it's good to know which curve is the main curve if you want to tune, for instance, a centered main curve in a complex structure. It's hard to see when you have lots of branches. So it's a neat little feature. The next one is curve length. And this is actually a parameter that you can use to animate the length of the curve structure. As we spoke about in the previous videos, you have something called max nodes as well. This is the limitation for how far or how long a curve can grow. The maximum number of nodes So the longest curve in this structure is limited by 30 nodes in this case. As I said previously as well, the max nodes is not for animating growth, but you can use the curve length to animate growth if you want to animate it in the SPC operator. In a later video, I will show you the MeshOp called Sprout Path, which is the best option if you want to animate growth. But we'll go into those details later on. You may wonder what the difference is between animating the curve length parameter and the max node parameter. When I scrub time here, we are animating the max nodes. And it's kind of a cool result, but there are actually some issues here. If you look at the base of the structure here, you can see that the geometry is flickering when I scrub time. And this is because the SPC operator is kind of a simulation. So at this stage, the curves are connected in a different way than they are here. So the main curve is changing depending on where we are here. To show you this, I will turn off the curve measure and display the main branch. And if you look at the main branch now, you will see that it changes all the time for every frame. So the longest branch, which is the reference for the curve measure, will change along the animation. If I instead move or change the curve length, let me select that one, curve length, and grab the channel hole here. You can see that the main curve stays the same. That is because this is a post effect after the SPC operation has done its computations. The result is a bit different here. It's more smooth. And personally, I think that animating the max nodes looks a bit cooler. But that depends on what kind of effect you want to achieve. The last parameter in this section is the node culling parameter. And let me hide the helper there. You can see that we have some short branches here. They consist of fewer nodes. This one is based on 2 nodes. This one is based on 3 nodes. The culling option here lets you remove nodes. So if I set it to 2, you can see that the ones with 2 nodes disappear. If I increase it to 3, the ones with 3 nodes disappear, and so on. And it's useful for many things. You can, if you just want to remove shorter branches at the trunk, which you can get in some situations, or if you want to just make the complete structure a bit less complex, just keep the longer branches. That's the option to use them. Okay, we are back to the original scene here. The next 3 parameters are covered in detail in the first video, and I suggest you take a look at that video if you haven't seen it yet. But very briefly, if we decrease the influence radius, we will get more crooked curves. If we increase it, we will get more straight curves. I'll set it back to the default value. We will go into the vertex mode. If I decrease the step length, you can see that the distance between the vertices are decreased. And if I want to grow the structure a bit more longer, I need to increase the max nodes. Right, let's put that back to the default value. And the last parameter, the kill distance. If I decrease that one, we have kind of iterations for the detail in the structure. So if we look at the branches here now, we can see that they are crooked, curvy, and maybe you want to have more straight branches. So there are a few post effects to help you control this. First of all, we have the density control, but we will start with the direction constraint. So this gradient represents the curves. So from the left side of the gradient, we are at the root, and on the right side of the gradient, we are at the top of the tree. This means that if I increase the right part, you can see that the tops of the tree get more straight. So this is a way of designing the look of your tree. This is a bit costly and affects performance once you get more complex structures. I will turn that off now. Let's take a look at density control. We have the same situation here. The left part of the gradient represents the root, and the right part of the gradient more towards the top. If I increase the right part here, we can see that we get more detail. And I can adjust this like this. And now comes the interesting part. If I increase the kill distance, we can see that we have more detail up here. And take a look at this. We will have more branching towards the top here. So when the kill distance is set to 1, we have less effect because we already have much detail in the tree. So to use the density control, we often need to have a kill distance larger than 1 to get a great effect. And in combination with the direction constraint, I will decrease that a bit. We can start making trees that looks a little bit more realistic. So those two options are very powerful, and something you should explore and experiment with to design your look and feel of your trees. What is important to know here is that since these are post effects, if you have branches or curve structures, climbing meshes, extreme values to these parameters can cause the curves to intersect with the mesh that you are climbing. So be careful using this when you're climbing meshes, at least two extreme values. All right, gravity. Gravity is kind of interesting in tropism, because gravity is not only about the bending of the branches towards the ground. It's also a force that resists growth. And the current gravity implementation in tropism tries to mimic both the branch bending and the growth resistance. And you can see here that the default value is 0. And it equals the gravity on Earth, basically. So I will show you what it looks like in this scene. As I increase gravity, and the maximum value right now is 15 here. And I decrease gravity, and we have inversed gravity. And it's kind of real time, but in complex scenes, it's a bit heavy when it comes to computation. And to show you the real effect, I loaded a scene here. I will go into advanced mode to see a little bit better what it looks like. This is a full tree generated by Tropism. So let's go into the SPC operator here, and you can see that the gravity is set to 3 right now. Let's set it to 0 and see what happens. And it will take some time to calculate. And you can see that the branches are more pointing more upwards here. And let's go to minus 3 to get the inverse gravity effect. There we go. Now you can see you have a totally different looking tree here. So you can shape the tree with gravity. And I will also put in 15 here just to make you see the effect. What happens here now is that the branches, they cannot spread out as much as before, and there are actually less branching right now. So gravity is cool, but it takes some time to calculate in complex scene like this one. Back to the original scene again. Okay, the next parameters here are actually does not have anything to do with the gravity. I will put in a divider there. If we look at the drawing here, the GL drawing in the view, you can see that there are some circles here. Those represent the step length distance. And also the direction, the start direction from the root. So I can inverse the start direction. Now the SPC operator tries to walk downwards, but since there are no points here, it will be forced to walk upwards. And you can specify different directions here. And of course you see there is a difference in the result here. So when you are climbing meshes, you want to aim this towards the mesh in different ways to get different results. Often it's not good to aim it directly towards the surface, but more in an angle. So you get a natural bending of the curve of the surface. I will show you this later on. Okay, let's talk about how to make tropism climb meshes. I have a scene with a simple mesh, and it's a torus, and there are actually two ways you can achieve a climbing effect. One is to add the SPC operator directly on the mesh. And I will move this one. And we will go into the SPC operator and take a look at the climbing mesh here. I have to enable climb surface. And you can see that the first choice here is scattered points. And that is actually the first option that you can configure tropism to climb meshes. In this case, we need to use the local vertices on this mesh. So we have to select the local mesh points. And now you can see that we have curves generated here. I will add a curve measure on top of this one, just to make it more visible. And let's decrease that a bit. Okay, something like that. So now you can see we have very bad climbing of this mesh, and that depends on the configuration of the SPC operator. So first of all, we need to decrease the radiuses here. And we are also discussing this in the first video, why we need to do that. So I suggest take a look at that one. We can also see that we are exactly at the edge here, and that's not good. So I will move the operator a bit like that. And I will make it a bit, offsetting the surface a bit here. We have to increase the nodes, and I need to enable the curve measure to grow all and the full length of the curve. So now you can see we have curves that are walking the surface. We have different results when we move this to different locations. And Now there is probably two little points on this mesh. I might need to subdivide it a bit. Looks kind of not so interesting. So I will subdivide the mesh a bit. And then you can see we have better growth. And it's growing kind of perfectly over the surface here. And now we can start to configure details and so on here. Here you can see we have some kind of penetration of the mesh here. And we will have to adjust this one a bit to find a good spot where it works. So this is the first option. So the polygons are in the base mesh here, and the SPC operator operates directly on this mesh. So I'm going to show you the second option here. Okay, I have prepared a scene to show you the second option, how to climb the mesh. This is a bit more complex setup, but it's much more powerful than the previous one. And we have two mesh layers. The tropism mesh here is the empty mesh with the operators in. The torus mesh is a simple mesh with the torus polygons in. You can see here when I hide it. And we connect the torus geometry to the surface mesh in the point scatter. And by that, we can enable the surface distribution on the mesh here. And you can see that we have small yellow dots on the mesh. And these helps the SPC operator to walk along the faces of this surface. What is also important to see here is that the torus mesh with the torus polygon data is also connected to the SPC operator climb surface slot. This is to the SPC operator needs to be aware of the surface polygons and the normals and so on to be able to climb the surface correctly. Now you can see that I have the scattered points option selected here. If I choose the local mesh points, there's a bug in Modo there, you can see that we have no climbing, and that's because there is no geometry data in the tropism mesh, basically. So I will set that back to scattered points. Now you can see we have nice climbing of the mesh here. What you can do when you have this point scatter configured in this setup, you have much more option to generate random structures by changing the seed. You can also change the number of points here and get lots of different variations of how the climbing occurs. Let's lower this one a bit. Now we can see it's too low, so we don't reach the points. I will increase it, and eventually we will get some cool climbing here. When you have the point scatter in the setup as well, you have the option to offset the points, as we discussed in the previous video. So I can offset the points here. Oh, that was a bit too much. And now you can see we have the curve follows the points. So the SPC operator kind of interpolates between the point positions and the surface position of the torus right now. So if you want to climb meshes, this is almost always the preferred way of doing it. We also have a parameter called seek radius. And this is a radius that the SPC operator uses to find polygons. When we have curves and we adjust them to not intersect the surface, we need to find the closest polygon and we need to adjust to it. And this seek radius basically limits how far the searching for polygons will be. And it's interesting to see here, if you look at the curve generation, because in the statistics here, that's where these calculations occur. If I increase the seek radius, you will see it will be more expensive. So with this parameter, you can really optimize the performance. You have an additional radius visible in the viewport here as well. So you want to decrease this to as low as possible. If you decrease it too much, you will see artifacts in some situations. So be careful there, but you want it as low as possible to get the best performance. What you can do more here is to add additional routes to the scene. So I have created a locator. I will drag it to the schematics and connect it to the route locators. And I will enable it so we can see it displayed in viewport. So now you can see we have two different routes and they are actually competing for space. But they are doing it on the same terms, namely the SPC operation configuration. There's an option to override this configuration per route. So if you select the locator, you will find a vertical tab and then you can click override settings. And now these are way too large values. So I will adjust them a bit and see what we can get. Now we can see we have a very small growth from this route here. But as I increase the nodes, it should push away and start competing for space. And you can see as the curves grow longer, they will also gain some thickness. That's why they are very thin here when they're that short. So here we are competing for space on the surface. And this works as well in volumes. So you can compete for space in volumes too. You can connect any number of nodes to this slot. As you connect more nodes, the computation time will of course increase. One last topic I wanted to cover here. If you are using Modo 13, you have the option to merge particle systems into a mesh. And that's pretty cool because then the SPC operator can read the particles. And I created a scene just to show you what you can achieve with this. And the performance is actually really good. So here you can see some kind of lightning bolts evolving and they follow the flow of particles here. And this is a cached simulation, but it is even good performance when running simulation without a cache. The cool thing with a cache is once you have it cached here, you can go to frame and then you can tweak Tropism at that frame and continue to run the simulation. I find this really cool actually. All right, I think that's about it. We are close to half an hour video now. Thank you very much for this session. I hope you enjoyed it as much as I did making it. See you in the next one. Bye bye.